Welcome back. It's Misha Amy. I'm Amy the Crafty Coilock, and this is episode 2 of Real Revolutionaries, Irish Women in History. Today we're talking about Cumann. If you haven't seen episode 1, I'm going to put the tag up here. And in episode 1, I talked about Inghinidhe and hÉireann, or the Daughters of Ireland, which was an Irish nationalist women's organisation which in 1914 dissolved and became Cumann for the most part. Now, Cumann was regarded as the women's arm of the Irish Volunteers, and their aims were to advance the cause of Irish liberty, to organise women in the organisation of that objective, to assist and equip men, Irish men, for the defence of Ireland, and to also form and raise funds for the purposes of defence, and that fund was called the Defence of Ireland Fund. Very simple stuff. They were also involved in other activities such as first aid training, drill and signalling training, and also rifle practice. And Patrick Pearce is quoted as saying that, "I would not like to think of women drilling and marching in the ordinary way, but there is no reason that they shouldn't learn how to shoot." Intiam lat, Fodrick, intiam lat. Similarly to Inghinidhe and hÉireann, Cumann organised entertainment nights that were based around Irish heritage and culture, such as ceilidhs, concerts, that kind of thing. These entertainment nights were specifically organised to drum up funds for the Defence of Ireland Fund. They also adopted a green uniform made of Irish tweed or volunteer tweed, which was a green colour consisting of a jacket and skirt, and also a slouch cap, which you can see here. Now, when Cumann first paraded in public in this uniform, they were pelted with mud and stones, mostly by the wives of British Army soldiers. There were also criticisms from other feminist groups who felt that the aims of Cumann were a step in the wrong direction for female emancipation, which they had been fighting for quite some time. And a suffrage publication called The Irish Citizen called members of Cumann female slaves and handmaidens to the Irish Volunteers. This was addressed by Mary Cullum, who spoke for a lot of women in Cumann when she stated in Irish Freedom that Cumann members were not the auxiliaries or the handmaidens or the camp followers of the Volunteers, but their allies. Cumann very much saw themselves as equal to and allies of the Irish Volunteers and the Irish rebels who fought for Irish freedom. And in speeches to Cumann members from Countess Markovitch, who was their president, this very much was sentiment that was felt not only among the women in Cumann, but also the men that were also fighting for freedom beside them. Now, I can kind of understand the criticisms, given that the main objectives of Cumann were to aid the men that were fighting for Irish freedom. But even after the 1916 Rising, Cumann continued to fight for Irish freedom and also for women's rights. During their 1918 convention, members restated their role in fighting for an Irish Republic, highlighting that they would follow the policy of the Republican Proclamation by seeing that women take up their proper position in the life of the nation, which meant to be full and equal citizens of the new republic. It is very much worth noting that although in 1914, when they had their first meeting, that Agnes O'Farrelly ruled out women taking up arms or being part of the physical fight during the Easter Rising and during the rebellion and fight for the Free State, women still did take up arms. Notably, Margaret Skinner, who was a Cumann member and a Conor na Gaeilge member at the time, was one of the women that took up arms. Now, I'm not going to go into detail about that right now because I am planning to do a profile video on Margaret later on in the series, but it is very much worth noting that while it seems like they were just playing a supporting role. Women very much were involved in being messengers, organizing a lot of the rebellion, the arms, hiding soldiers, and really playing a strategic role in it all. After the rising of 1916, it became very clear to authorities that women were playing a pivotal role in the rebellion and in the organization of the nationalist movements, which in turn led to further pressures being put on them. Particularly, it's noted in Lil Collins' memoir that between April and September in 1921, attention had been focused on the women very much at this time. They realized fully that women were playing a major part in the campaign, and also it's noted that the going was tough on the female sex. They were unable to go on the run, so they were constantly subjected to having their homes raided and precious possessions destroyed. So they were unable to go on the run like their male counterparts, and yet they were still having to deal with the fallout from being involved in the rebellion. The quote goes on to say, "To intensify the reign of terror, swoops were made in the night, entries forced into their homes, and the women's hair cut off in a brutal fashion, as well as suffering other indignities and insults." In her book, No Ordinary Women, Irish Female Activists in the Revolutionary Years from 1900 to 1923, Sinéad McCool tells the story of many female revolutionaries, members of Cumann na mBan, Inghinidhe na hÉireann, and other nationalist organisations whose stories haven't been told, whose families came forward years later and were surprised that their mothers, grandmothers, aunts, sisters were involved in these rebellions. But given the information that we have about how these women were treated, is it any wonder why they didn't talk about it afterwards? Particularly given the fact that the Easter Rising wasn't that popular at the time with the majority. It's only in recent years that we're learning more about these women, their stories, and what they did to fight for Irish freedom. And I'll put a link in the description below, but I would highly recommend anyone that's interested in this to get that book because it's an absolutely great resource in telling the stories not only of the history of these organizations, but also of the individual women and what they did for this country. There's also many other resources, like from the National Library of Ireland and also from Richmond Barracks, which I'll also put in the links in the description. This is where I'm getting all of my information for these videos and also has led me to further resources to learn more about these women. But now I'm going to go back to talking about Cumann na mBan. Cumann na mBan was led by the infamous Countess Constance Markievicz, who was elected their president in 1914 and was also elected Chapta Dála or TD, member of the Irish government in 1918. She was the first female elected member of the UK House of Commons, but due to her party's political affiliation, due to her party's political policy in Sinn Féin, she was an abstentionist, which meant that she was not going to take her physical seat in the House of Commons. Also, she was in prison at the time, so that also would have prevented her from taking her seat. She instead insisted of the formation of Dáil Éireann, which is the Assembly of Ireland, and held the position of Minister for Labour from 1919 to 1922. She was the first and only female cabinet member of the Irish government until 1979. There's an interview with fellow Cumann na mBan member Moira Comerford, which is also on YouTube, which I'll link in the description below, which shows Moira talking about the return of Constance Markievicz when she was released from prison. Éirigh Chogan na Saoirse, during the Irish War of Independence, which is also known as the Anglo-Irish War, members of Cumann na mBan were still actively helping to house and hide volunteers and arms for the cause of Irish freedom. They also helped run Dáil Éireann and also helped with the governance of local authorities. They also helped in the publishing of the Irish Bulletin, which was the official Irish Republic newspaper. In May 1921, fellow Cumann members Mary McSwinney, Dr. Ada English, and also Kathleen Clark joined Constance Markovich as Chochtaí Dolí, or TDs, in the Irish government. Just over 6 months later, on the 7th of January 1922, the Anglo-Irish Treaty was approved by the second Dáil by a very close vote. And a few weeks later, Cumann held a convention on February 5th. During the convention, 419 Cumann members voted against the treaty, with only 63 voting in favour. And following this, the Irish Civil War saw Cumann members largely support the anti-treaty Republican forces. Over 400 of its members were imprisoned by forces of the Provisional Government, which became, in December 1922, the Irish Free State. Some of the pro-treaty members changed their name to Cumann na Saoirse, or the Council of Freedom, while others retained the Cumann na mBan name, but openly gave allegiance to the Free State government. Cumann na mBan continued to exist after the treaty, forming part of the Irish Republican scene alongside Sinn Féin, the Irish Republican Army, Fianna Éireann, and other Republican groups. The government of the Free State banned the organisation in January 1923, just a month after they were elected to governance. Kilmainham Jail in Dublin was also used as a detention centre for suspected and confirmed members of Cumann na mBan after 1923. And Sinead McCool, in her book, No Ordinary Women, which I've mentioned already, details the experiences of women in Kilmainham Jail. And also, it's the location of her first exhibition called Guns and Chiffon, which was opened in 1997 by Ireland's first female president, Mary Robinson. The strength of the organisation was very badly affected by the splits in Irish republicanism that were happening, with sections of the membership resigning from Cumann na mBan to join Fianna Fáil and other parties. In fact, Countess Markovich was one of the founding members in Fianna Fáil, which was founded in 1926. Moira Comerford, who was a lifelong member of Cumann na mBan from 1914, later reflected that Cumann na mBan became a greatly weakened organisation that gathered speed downhill from the founding of Fianna Fáil in 1926. In later years, Cumann na mBan and its members did become integrated into conflicts in Northern Ireland, notably within the Republican sphere and Republican scene. And this led to them being integrated somewhat with the Irish Republican Army and also the Sinn Féin political party, as a lot of its members were part of either one of those organisations while also being members of Cumann na mBan. In 2000, the UK government, under the Terrorism Act of 2000, deemed Cumann na mBan a proscribed organisation. And then in 2014, Cumann na mBan celebrated the centenary of their foundation, again at Wynn's Hotel, where they were founded 100 years prior. So, Sinead for Cumann na mBan, that's it for Cumann na mBan. I will be focusing on individual women in this series going forward. If you do have any special requests, just drop them in the comments. If you liked this video, just give it a like. And if you'd like to follow along for the rest of the series, do hit subscribe. It helps boost the channel and it also helps keep you informed for when the videos come out. I do hope to upload one every week. And I'll also start uploading different content that's not just about Irish women revolutionaries. So I have lots of content planned. So do give a like and subscribe if you're enjoying the channel. And I hope to see you soon. Slán go fóill. I almost forgot to show off my t-shirt that I wore especially for this video. So I'm probably going to have to move the camera around here. But it says, a woman's place is in the revolution. Which it is. So this is actually a Star Wars t-shirt, but I like it. And I think it was very apt to wear for this video. So, Slán.